Okay, the next item of business is a debate on motion 11161 in the name of Neil Gray on fair work in a wellbeing economy. I'd invite members wishing to participate in the debate to press the request to speak buttons, and I call on the Cabinet Secretary to speak to and move the motion for around 12 minutes. Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I move the motion in my name and that of my colleagues. Our vision is for a wellbeing economy which supports fair and green economic growth, and which benefits people and communities across Scotland, providing opportunities for all. And this government has been clear that economic activity should serve a purpose to provide good jobs, and promote fair work, to reduce poverty and increase living standards, and to boost tax revenues and sustain high-quality public services. We want to build an economy where our businesses and industries thrive and where economic success works for all. A successful wellbeing economy is underpinned by our ambition to be a leading Fair Work nation in 2025, an ambition we share with the Fair Work Convention. To be a country where fair work drives success, well-being and prosperity for individuals, businesses, organisations and society as a whole. So I welcomed the Convention's recent Fair Work Nation 2025 research report, which is a significant and welcome step in measuring progress against our shared ambition. And we are making progress. Figures released just this last week on earnings show that annual growth in median weekly earnings for full-time employees in Scotland between April 22 and April 2023 was up 9.7% compared to a 6.2% increase for the UK as a whole. In 2023, the gender pay gap for all employees in Scotland was 8.7%, which is lower than the comparable figure for the UK at 14.3%. The gender pay gap for full-time employees in Scotland is 1.7%, also lower than the comparable figure for the UK at 7.7%, and continues the long-term downward trend. In April 22, the proportion of employees in Scotland paid the real living wage or more was 91%. Scotland leads the rest of the UK in paying employees the real living wage. I give way to Mr Johnson.
Daniel Johnson.
And I'm very grateful to the Cabinet Secretary for doing so. The Fair Work Convention's report also highlighted a number of areas where the Scottish Government could go further. Which of those do you think is the most important in terms of the Scottish Government's next steps?
Cabinet Secretary.
As I said, I welcomed the report of the Fair Work Convention, which was a very helpful measure of where we are in terms of the progress that we're making, but also challenging in terms of us needing to go further. We continue to work with the Fair Work Convention. I meet with them regularly and support the measures that they have come forward to suggest to us we need to do more work on, which is within the areas that we're already considering around our Fair Work Action Plans, ensuring that we are responding not just to the needs that they are identifying, but also the trade union organisations that the Labour Party in its amendment appears to ignore around the devolution of employment law. A report by the Living Wage Foundation, published in August, indicates, in addition to Scotland having the lowest levels of pay in the UK, it also has the lowest levels of insecure work and low-paid insecure work in the UK. This same report specifically recognised the positive impact our Fair Work approach is having on Scotland's labour market. Fair Work is about promoting a more ambitious and positive agenda for Scotland's workplaces and wider economy. Putting Fair Work at the heart of Scotland's workplaces makes economic sense. The workplace is where we apply people's skills and talents to create value, drive innovation, raise productivity, fund our public services and ultimately improve living standards for all. I give way.
Brian Whittle.
I'm very grateful to the Cabinet Secretary to give him way. What are the Scottish Government going to do to tackle the high levels of economically inactive people in Scotland, especially those through ill health?
Cabinet Secretary.
So levels of economic inactivity are too high in Scotland, as they are across the whole of the UK. And we obviously need to be looking at what can be done to address that. I actually met with Michael Matheson, the Health Secretary, this week around what more can be done to ensure we are using the health service, using all the levers that we have at our disposal to support those with long-term health conditions or disabilities to go to work if they can, and continue to support the work of the voluntary employability services that we're investing £108 million in to support just that. But a Fair Work approach is proven to boost recruitment, retention and performance and generate benefits for individuals, organisations and wider society. The evidence is mounting. Fair Work balances the rights and responsibilities of workers and employers, and this government's deliberate and sustained approach to promoting fair work across Scotland's labour market is making a difference. On pay, supporting diverse workplaces, our devolved employability offer, applying fair work principles and conditionality to public sector spend, and exploring fair work agreements. So let me just share some of the successes to date. This government recently welcomed the new real living wage rate of £12 an hour and has resolutely supported the real living wage movement in Scotland since becoming the first UK government to accredit as a living wage employer in 2015. Some 64,000 workers in Scotland have had a pay rise as a result of living wage employer accreditation, and the movement is making a real difference for people in the lowest paid areas. Earlier this week, the Scottish Government announced its living hours accreditation, making it the first national administration in the UK to accredit as a living hours employer. And this accreditation recognises the importance of sufficient, reliable working hours to achieve financial security for workers. I've been able to hear more about that success that has brought to employers, both private and third sector, in the visits that I've done as part of 21 ministerial engagements for Living Wage Week this week. And I understand, in a UK cost crisis, making the choice to invest in a business's greatest asset, its people, is harder. But actually, it's even more of an imperative in such a difficult trading environment. Indeed, I'm looking forward to celebrating the achievements of accredited employers across Scotland later this evening at the annual Living Wage Scotland Awards ceremony in Dundee. I'll give away for a final time.
Mardo Fraser.
I'm grateful to the Cabinet Secretary for giving way. We're 6 minutes into his speech. He hasn't mentioned the wording of his motion, which is very specific wording, a very specific call on the devolution of employment law. Now, we hear a lot about the New Deal for Business and the Minister's Cabinet Secretary's engagement with business. What percentage of the businesses he's engaging with have supported the call for devolution of employment law?
Cabinet Secretary, I'll give you the time back for the intervention.
Thank you, and I appreciate that, Presiding Officer. I note from Murdo Fraser's amendment that it has little more than a passing mention to Fair Work, which gives the hesitation that the Conservative Party wish to engage on the Fair Work agenda within this context. And I'll be more than happy to address the point that he raises, because of course the New Deal for Business discussions around ensuring the wellbeing economy subgroup of those elements, of course there is a sign up and an understanding of the need for Fair Work conditionality and for Fair Work within workplaces. And there is a pretty well-recognised acceptance across Scotland, including from members of the business community, of the advantages that could come from the devolution of employment law, including to the advantages that can come from businesses themselves. Scotland's employability services, underpinned by our No One Left Behind approach, delivers person-centred, responsive services that meet the needs of individuals, employers and local labour markets. And we're investing up to £108 million this year in the delivery of all-age employability support. On my recent visit to All in Dundee, I heard about the positive impact our distinctly Scottish approach to employability is having in supporting disabled people into employment. And our distinctive approach to key relationships in Scotland is working for us. The New Deal for Business is heralding an effective partnership working with business and the economy. The Verity House Agreement is resetting how we work with local government to deliver key public services and recognise the contribution of workforce at a local level. And this government understands the importance of a Fair Work approach to unlock the full potential of our workforce and achieve a thriving, fair and green growing economy. Our actions show our determination to be a successful, leading Fair Work nation in spite of the inaction from the UK government. However, inequalities remain and insecure work persists. Although Scotland has one of the lowest levels of insecure work in the UK, it remains a concerning feature within our economy. So the evidence is clear that comparator nations, the Nordics, Austria, Belgium, for instance, outperform the UK across a range of economic and social indicators. Better labour market outcomes are achieved alongside higher GDP per capita, higher productivity, higher business investment and higher innovation. The UK's deregulated labour market has not supported higher productivity, growth or higher wages, but it has led to relatively high prevalence of both low and very high wages, resulting in higher income inequality. The type of labour market we support has a bearing on the overall functioning of our society. With full control over employment law, the Scottish Government could choose a balance to the rights and responsibilities of workers and employment and employers, creating a labour market where Fair Work is the norm. The changing nature of work And the growth in atypical work in the last 20 years, for example, self-employed, part-time, agency, temporary, zero-hours contracts, multi-job, gig economy and platform work, means there is a gap in worker protections. This was highlighted in the UK government's very own Taylor review of modern working practices in 2017. Now, I understand that it's challenging in those areas to bring forward the reforms required, but workers in non-standard working patterns often have no entitlement to statutory sick pay, maternity leave, or other paid leave. And they are also likely to have reduced opportunity to train and progress in work. Therefore, raising minimum standards for all our workers, not just those in standard full-time jobs, requires deliberate corrective action. And recent Westminster government labour market policies seem to be moving in the opposite direction. They include inadequate enforcement of minimum employment standards, including the national minimum wage, the introduction of the Trade Union Act 2016, making it more difficult for trade unions to take industrial action and to organise in the workplace, plans to introduce fees for employment tribunals, and the Strikes Act of this year. So members of this government have repeatedly voiced our opposition to the UK government's retained EU Law Act and anti-trade union legislation. The recent Strikes Act is unnecessary, unwanted, ineffective. It undermines legitimate trade union activity, does not respect the Scottish Government's fair work principles and the devolution settlement. The Scottish Trade Unions Congress agrees, as does the UK TUC, which backed a motion calling for the devolution of employment law to Scotland, as the STUC reiterates in their briefing for this debate. The devolution of employment law offers an opportunity to redesign the system to better meet the needs of both workers and employers. Further measures could draw on the recommendations of recent commissions, such as the Taylor Review that I previously mentioned, the Institute for Public Policy Research, Commission on Economic Justice as well. And in building a new Scotland, a stronger economy with independence, we propose several measures which could also be implemented with the devolution of employment law or through independence. For example, a fair mandatory national minimum wage that reflects the cost of living, improved access to flexible working, repeal the Trade Union Act 2016, gender pay gap reporting for companies with fewer than 250 employers. And we also continue to call for the devolution of access to work to ensure that this programme, which supports people with a health condition or disability, is delivered in such a way that respects the needs of Scotland's labour market. So to conclude, Presiding Officer, we do not support this UK government's economic model, which actively promotes a deterioration of workers' rights, deprioritises the global imperative of a green and just transition to net zero. Scotland has its own distinct needs and values, and so instead we're pursuing a green transition supported by our energy sector just transition plans and forthcoming green industrial strategy. We're pursuing fair work, good jobs, rising productivity across our workplaces and regions, and we're pursuing a well-being economy and social justice as key outcomes for economic growth. But we could move faster, securing the full range of powers in relation to employment law will enable the Scottish Parliament to implement policies in favour of our ambition for a fair green growing economy, and we call on members of this Parliament to support devolution of employment powers as a clear next step in this agenda.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. I can advise the Chamber we do have a little bit of time in hand, so any interventions will certainly have the time back. I now call on Murdo Fraser to speak to and move amendment 1161.2 for around 8 minutes. Mr Fraser.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Well, this has been a rather bizarre debate so far, because despite we've had one long speech from the Cabinet Secretary and various interventions, but despite being entitled Fair Work and a Wellbeing Economy, there's no mention in the Cabinet Secretary's motion of the wellbeing economy at all. The motion is entirely focused on the constitutional question, on the devolution of employment powers to the Scottish Parliament. But you know, the Cabinet Secretary seemed remarkably coy about that subject, because it had not been for my intervention, he was 9 minutes into a 12-minute speech before he even mentioned that question of devolution of employment law. So maybe he's a little bit embarrassed about taking this to the Chamber. And I think the question many people outside this Chamber looking in will be asking themselves, having heard everything he had to say, is what happened to the New Deal for Business? The New Deal for Business that we've heard so much about, because there was nothing in the Cabinet Secretary's speech that gave any comfort to those in the business community who are looking for a new approach from this government. The rhetoric we've heard from the government over the last few weeks has been encouraging. We've heard from the Cabinet Secretary and his colleagues that, that this is a government that wants to reset its relationship with the business community. We've heard this is a government that now believes in economic growth, something that was absent for many years previously, but is now a very welcome development. When the First Minister delivered his programme for government speech a few months back, he said this: when businesses succeed, Scotland succeeds. It is on the back of the successes of businesses, large and small, that we will deliver a well-being economy where good, well-paid, sustainable jobs are created and innovation flourishes. That's a tremendous sentiment, Cabinet Secretary. What a pity we didn't hear very much of that in his speech. And I hope that when we were going to have a debate on the well-being economy, we were going to hear from the government more about how they were going to take forward their New Deal for business, that they were actually listening to what business was telling them, as I'm sure they're telling them what they're telling us. They want to see issues around taxation, on excessive regulation, on the need to properly consult before bringing in new laws. These are the issues that need to be addressed. But what do we get instead from the Cabinet Secretary? The same tired old message on the Constitution. Oh, yes. Yes, I'll give way to Mr McKee.
Does Mr Fraser not recognise the international data quite clearly shows that countries and economies that prioritise fair work and have high standards of protection and high wages for employees are also economies that have high levels of productivity where business thrives?
So I think Mr McKee, who I know had a record in business, needs to be listening to what the voices of business are saying the Scottish Government needs to be focusing on right now. Now, Presiding Officer, so what we should be talking about is how we help grow the economy and what the role of businesses in that. Instead, what are we talking about? Yet another SNP demand for more powers to be passed down from Westminster to this place, completely ignoring the fact that this government's made a total mess of the powers it already holds. Yep. But let me just, for the sake of the debate, and yes, of course.
Minister.
I wonder if Mr Fraser expects us to take seriously the notion of a Conservative member of the Scottish Parliament standing up talking about the need for economic growth when it's his party, through the disaster zone of the Liz Truss quasi-quarting mini-budget, that's crashed the economy.
Yeah, Murdoch Fraser.
Absolute nonsense. I don't know if the Minister's actually looked at what's happened in the economy elsewhere in the world. In terms of the G7, the UK economy is performing better than many competitor countries, performing much better than Germany, expected to perform better than France and Italy. And you know, this is the Scottish Government. Let's just look. So even if the UK economy, according to the Minister, is not performing well, let's look at how the Scottish economy is doing in relative terms. Since 2014, the Scottish economy has grown on average, under the watch of the Minister and his colleagues, at half the rate of the UK economy, Presiding Officer. And we can't ignore that simple fact. So let me go back to what I was trying to say, because let's try and unpick exactly what this motion is about. And what the government are trying to achieve beyond just weary constitutional points which they're so keen to make. Or perhaps this is all about laying a trap for the Labour Party, which I suspect really is what this debate is about this afternoon. So, Presiding Officer, there's no point devolving employment law to the Scottish Parliament if the government's intention is we just leave it as it is. So they're either going to make them more liberal or more restrictive, and I think from what we've heard, there's not much of an intention to make them more liberal. So let's assume they're going to be more restrictive than in other parts of the United Kingdom. And that therefore flies in the face of everything we have heard from the business community over the last few weeks and months. Already it's a major concern of the business community that we see a divergence between Scotland and the rest of the UK in terms of tax. A divergence is having a real impact on business. It's a point made in budget submissions currently being published by the likes of the Scottish Retail Consortium and the CBI in Scotland, amongst others. And every time I meet business, one of their major asks is that the Scottish Government tackles that tax differential, a tax differential which is now an active barrier to encouraging people to come and move and take jobs in Scotland. And if the Cabinet Secretary hasn't heard that message loud and clear from the business community, then he hasn't been listening. I'll give way to Mr Mason.
John Mason.
I thank Murdoch Fraser for giving way. Would you at least accept that there is quite a lot of variety in the business community, and whereas some of them do need more support, others are making huge profits and could pay and should pay more tax?
Murdoch Fraser, as
well,
I
think Mr Mason needs to go and engage with major figures in the business community, and particularly in sectors like finance, who have a very fluid and flexible workforce of people who can work in Edinburgh or in Glasgow, or they can work in Newcastle or Leeds or London and find out what they are saying about the impact of differential tax rates. No, look, I've given way about four or five times. I really need to make some progress. Rather than learn that message, learn the lesson from that experience, this government wants to go further and create a different employment law regime here in Scotland. That's not going to attract investment here in Scotland compared to other parts of the UK. I can only imagine there are people in charge of economic development in cities like Bristol or Manchester or Newcastle rubbing their hands in glee at the prospect of... No, I've already taken a number of interventions, Mr. Swinney. I need to make some progress. And this would cause real practical issues for large cross-border employers. A member of staff in Scotland would have different employment rights to one elsewhere in the UK. So a member of staff who moved, for example, from Manchester to Glasgow would potentially benefit from greater employment rights, and one moving in the other direction, the opposite would be the case. It would be an administrative nightmare. But all this tells us is what the true priority of the SNP Green government would be when it comes to the economy. It's not about delivering faster growth. It's not about helping businesses expand. It's not about improving the woeful start-up rate we have or increasing the number of secure, well-paid jobs. What's this debate about, presiding officer? It's about creating a constitutional fight with Westminster, because that is what this government is obsessed with, to the exclusion of everything else. There are real issues with the Scottish economy today this government needs to be addressing. That is why this afternoon we should be looking at the real problems in the Scottish economy and what we can do to address them. So this week I read the CBI Scotland's budget submission, making some excellent suggestions around realising Scotland's net zero opportunities, developing infrastructure, improving transport, enhancing skills and fostering a competitive business environment. Other business organisation submissions are available, but they all have a very similar theme. They want to see this government creating an environment where businesses can grow, where they can expand their workforce and therefore can pay better wages. And they will do that with the right framework of support, not with further regulations and additional burdens, which is the direction this government is going in. And already, and in contrast to what the Cabinet Secretary had to say, the UK government has delivered significant progress in supporting workers. It was the UK government that introduced the national living wage, now at £10.42 per hour. And in addition, the rise in income tax thresholds mean that many lower paid workers pay next to no income tax on what they earn. And what the Scottish Government needs to be doing is focusing on delivering faster growth here. And if we could at least match UK economic growth over a 10-year period, that would give us an extra £7 billion in tax revenues we could spend, which would go a long way to addressing many of the budgetary challenges facing the Scottish Government today. So, presiding officer, rather than focus on that objective of delivering economic growth, what we have here is a government obsessed over the Constitution, picking fights with Westminster, playing silly political games in this chamber, businesses looking in, hoping for a change in direction from this government, hoping that the New Deal for business will mean something other than empty words, will be sorely disappointed. I move the amendment in my name.
Thank you very much. Mr Fraser, as I say, there's a bit of time in hand, so members will get the time back if they take interventions. That should underscore the fact that people should not be making sedentary interventions. If you want to say something, get on your feet and ask for an intervention. With that, I now call on Daniel Johnson to speak to and move the amendment 11161.3 up to around 6 minutes. Mr Johnson.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. And can I move the amendment in my name? And let me begin with a declaration. When it comes to fair work, I think deeds matter much more than posture. And in my record, I'm very clear. As a person who ran my own business, my business was the first independent retailer in Edinburgh to become an accredited living wage employer. And I stand by that. And I stand by the deeds of past Labour governments. And I think there's much that we can agree with the government's motion this afternoon. But ultimately, it comes down to deeds rather than simply stated intent. But let's also be very clear. The UK Conservative Party has a wretched record on workers' rights. They have presided over an explosion in insecure work and the longest pay squeeze in history. Just in a moment. Working people are facing the largest fall in living standards in a generation. And despite what Mr Fraser says. There is a ticking time bomb of mortgage payments because of the disastrous consequences of the mini-budget which he so eagerly seeks to dismiss. Happy to give way.
Cabinet Secretary.
I thank Daniel Johnson for giving way. He sets out that there's much that he can agree with in the government motion, but he seeks to edit out the critical element, which is the call for the devolution of employment law. He says we should just be thinking about it. We might do it. And meantime, asks us to trust a Labour government to deliver after a summer of flip-flops that's seen this new deal for workers absolutely torn to shreds. How on earth can we trust Labour to deliver upon its promises?
Daniel Johnson, I give the time back.
The Cabinet Secretary really must learn patience, because I was just coming to that very, very point. And look, it's really very straightforward. And look, it is quite simple. We support the devolution of employment law. We agree with the statement made by the STUC, and we agree with them when they said that that must be done within the framework of a UK floor. And let's quote Ros Foyer. This is what she said when that motion passed to the TUC. A guaranteed minimum floor of workers' rights across the UK is a prudent first step, so that every worker in every workplace has a guaranteed standard of rights from day one of any future UK Labour government. That's the full position the STUC has set out. That is the full position that the Labour Party supports. It's just a shame that the SNP are so eager to edit out that full position. If I could just make a little bit of progress. And what is absolutely, just in a moment, and what is absolutely critical is perhaps summed up in Mr Fraser's comments, because he invited us to entertain what devolution, full devolution of employment law might mean. Could we have improved work standards or more liberal? And that is exactly the point. What we must have is an absolute guarantee for all workers across the UK, because we cannot predict, as much as we might like to control, what future Scottish administrations may look like. And we cannot afford a race to the bottom. And having unqualified devolution of employment would do just that, which is why the STUC take the position that you have to have that prudent first step of a floor, which is what Ros Foyer said. I'm very happy to
Minister.
I wonder then if it's Labour Party's position that they support the STU position, why have they removed any reference to the Scottish Trade Union Congress's position as we've laid out in our motion, and why is it, instead of saying that they support the devolution of employment law, it merely says that the UK government should explore how those rights could be devolved?
Daniel Johnson.
Well, if there's any ambiguity, I hope I've cleared it up, and I hope I've made myself clear in my statements. And let's just see what happens in the votes this afternoon. So let's be very clear about this government's record on the Fair Work agenda, because despite the government committing to making Scotland a leading Fair Work nation by 2025, the Fair Work Convention last month described the Scottish government's performance as mixed, and I quote, out of the 45 indicators considered, 19 have improved, 10 have worsened, and 14 have fluctuated or remained broadly stable. Indeed, the international comparisons are even worse. Scotland ranks fifth out of 9 compared to small countries. Our disability employment gap is 31 percentage points, second from bottom. 29% of our workers are in non-permanent work and not there by choice. That figure is 4% in Austria, 7% in Iceland. And most shockingly of all, 32% of Scottish workers are say they're overqualified for the role they perform, higher than every other competitor nation. Now, the government will say that this is the fault of the UK government, but look, the lesson is clear. Yes, you need enhanced employment standards, but that must be enmeshed within a system of enhanced skills and enhanced education. That's the lesson from Austria. That's the lesson from the Nordic countries. And indeed, these are points that the Scottish Government seeks to dismiss, to make the constitutional points that it prefers to make. And so let me be clear about what the government could do today to affect this situation. Firstly, an education and skills policy, which the recent review conducted by James Withers concluded that the approach from the Scottish government lacked leadership and direction. There is no more important resource than our people. And this government urgently needs to bring forward recommendations on how it can put flexibility and responsiveness at the heart of the skills system. And secondly, in terms of helping families with children, it's vital that we support parents and caregivers in the workplace. The government can and should do much more to provide flexible, all-age, all-year, wraparound, affordable early years care. And the STUC agrees. They say that there are a number of areas where the Scottish Government could go further to support Fair Work. But instead of finding practical ways, practical actions within devolution settlement to further and improve the lives of working people, the Scottish Government is intent on furthering constitutional grievance. That is why, I think I have to close, that is why we need a UK Labour government to enact Labour's New Deal for working people, which will ban zero-hours contracts, give workers predictable contracts, outlaw fire and rehire, give day one rights to every worker, and give workers the right to switch off. That is the difference that we need. That is why the TUC General Secretary, Paul Nowak, says that this would be the biggest upgrade in workers' rights in a generation, and that is why we need a Labour government. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Mr Johnson. I call Willie Rennie. Around 6 minutes, Mr Rennie.
According to the latest CBI Scottish Productivity Index, productivity grew in the UK in 2021 by 1.2%, but it remained unchanged in Scotland. According to the latest ONS figures, productivity in Scotland was 2.4% lower in 2021 compared with 2019, the second worst performing part of the UK on this measure. And again, according to that CBI Scottish Productivity Index, business investment was lower in Scotland in 2021 than the UK, 8% versus 9%. So even though UK productivity levels are low compared with other countries, Scotland is even further behind. For GDP, just in a second, for GDP, the most recent figures for 2023, quarter two, show GDP growth in the UK at 0.2%, but negative 0.3% in Scotland. Growth over the last 5 years was 1.6% in Scotland, but 2.6% across the UK. Over the last 10 years, there's an even larger gap, 9.8% in Scotland compared with 15.5% across the UK. Now, I think the Minister knows that it's not a convincing argument that his government should get more powers over employment law and the economy when its track record is so poor. Yes, I'll take an intervention.
John Swinney.
I'm very grateful to Mr Rennie for giving way. I think it's typical of the contribution that Mr Rennie makes to this debate that he does not give a broad range of indicators. He omitted the fact that the Scottish economy has outclassed every other part of the United Kingdom, apart from London in the South East, for inward investment for as many years as I can remember. Why does Mr Rennie have to come here with such a depressing tone for this debate?
Willie Rennie, I can give you the time back.
Because Mr Swinney is making a naive, optimistic presentation of an equally narrow set of figures as well. He makes no reference to the figures that I mentioned. He only chose his own narrow perspective. We need to have a broad perspective. I'm going to come on to the Wellbeing Monitor in a while, and it's important that we look at... No, not just now. We're going to look at the Wellbeing Monitor, which does have a broader view of these issues. But Mr Swinney does himself no favours by focusing on a narrow set of indicators himself. No, not just now. The Minister knows that. The Minister knows that he can't dwell on the productivity issues that we've talked about in this debate, because he doesn't even mention Scottish productivity in his own motion. He refers to other governments in other parts of the world because the productivity levels in Scotland are so lamentable. And despite that lamentable performance in Scotland, I'm not going to make the case today that there should be a transfer of powers from this Parliament to Westminster. I'm not going to do that. I'm not going to argue that suddenly we should get ferries built by the UK government just because this government can't build any ferries on the Clyde, or because the government seems incapable of delivering the adult disability payment even at the levels of the personal independence payments at a UK level. I'm not going to argue that there should be a transfer back of powers to the Westminster government because the government is so incompetent on these things. That would be wrong. What is right is that we get the powers in the right place that is best served for Scotland and the United Kingdom, for the people who live here. The performance, for instance, on the NHS is shocking. course, nobody's going to argue about the transfer back of powers to Westminster on that, or the Crown Estate, because this government bungled the ScotWind contract. So I'm not going to make any of those arguments today. And equally so, I'm not going to make the argument that we should have a transfer of employment and economic powers to this Parliament just because we've got a UK government that is, admittedly, utterly hopeless temporarily. No, not just now. I've got to get through a big part of this speech here. So I'm not going to argue for that transfer of that power because we've had several Prime Ministers who seem incompetent. I'm arguing for change across the UK so we can get the right government in the right places. And that applies equally here as it does in Westminster. So I'm not going to argue for all of those measures. I want employment law and economic powers to be part of the single market of the United Kingdom, because I want businesses who work here to be able to trade freely across the United Kingdom with as little barriers as possible. And I want to make sure that people who live and work here can equally live and work in other parts of the United Kingdom. That single market is the strength of the United Kingdom, and it's what Ming Campbell, Lord Campbell of Pitt and Weem, sent out in his Home Rule report back in 2012 for a modern Scottish Parliament in a federal United Kingdom, making sure we build in to the new constitutional structure a compulsion for the two governments to work in partnership together, rather as we've got just now, which is in competition with each other. But I talked about the Wellbeing Monitor. And the Wellbeing Monitor is something that government is, I think, rightly proud of. But I've challenged the government before that it should stop marking its own homework on that monitor. For instance, it claims it's making progress on educational attainment. But the attainment gap, the poverty-related attainment gap, is as wide as it's ever been. At best, it's stagnant in some areas, but it's definitely wider at S3. But it claims in the Wellbeing Monitor that somehow it's making progress in this area. Equally so, on GDP and investment and business investment, it's actually fallen back since 2017. So we do need an independent assessment of this Wellbeing Monitor, because it is important that people live in a good, healthy environment with a good NHS and a good environment that's not filled with sewage when they go out for a walk, that we've got schools that they can be proud to send their children to. All of those things are important, but for those things to be measured, they need to be measured in an authentic way, and the current system is clearly not working. And in conclusion, I think Murdo Fraser had a point earlier on. This is quite a striking contrast with the contributions that I've heard from the Minister before. It was supposed to be a new deal for business. And I'm not sure businesses will gain an awful lot of confidence today, because it is about a balance. It is about well-being, and it is about a strong economy.
You need to
economy.
Conclude, Mr. Rennie.
And if we don't have the strong economy, we won't have the jobs for people, and we won't have the opportunities for people. We need to have a stronger economy and a fairer society. This government is well off track, and it needs to get back
Thank
on
you,
track.
Thank you, Mr. Rennie. We now move to the open debate. I call first Ivan McKee, to be followed by Liz Smith. Around 6 minutes, Mr. McKee.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and delighted to be speaking this debate that the government has brought forward on the Fair Work agenda and the importance of those powers being transferred to this Scottish Parliament. Now, clearly, the Fair Work agenda is broad, covering as it does worker conditions, protections, recognitions and many critical aspects. I want to focus my remarks primarily on the setting of the minimum wage and the importance of that being transferred to this Scottish Parliament. It's an area that's been confused by the UK government, taking the minimum wage that was in place, responding to the real living wage by creating what they called the living wage, which isn't the real living wage and is or isn't the same as the minimum wage, just to confuse the whole picture. What we need is this Scottish Parliament to be in control of that Scottish minimum wage and setting that at a level that that meets the needs and aspirations, not just of Scotland's workers, but of our economy. And I'll come on to address some remarks as to how we might take that forward as I go through my contribution this afternoon. First of all, some mention has been made of data. And if you look specifically at, and the Cabinet Secretary has spoken about several of the areas where Scotland's economy has been performing well. If you look at the minimum wage or the real living wage performance in Scotland, the percentage of employees not earning that level of the real living wage has been thankfully trending down, still too high in the kind of mid-teens, but significantly lower than it has been. And those employees typically concentrated in some specific sectors that do have their challenges where that needs to be addressed. But it's worth recognising that across vast swathes of the economy, by far the vast majority of employees are already above or significantly above that level. So we are pushing an open door in many, many sectors as a consequence of that. It is, of course, a key economic lever setting of that minimum wage, absolutely critical to addressing the government's priority on the poverty agenda. Welfare, social security payments can only do so much. The heavy lifting on this needs to be carried by the broader economy, and having control over that lever is absolutely critical. As I've already highlighted in my interventions, and as the government has highlighted, the correlation between higher standards, employment standards, and a higher minimum wage correlates very closely with levels of productivity across a whole range of international economies, particularly as we focus on those growth sectors of the future. Because what we want to see in Scotland is a high wage, high productivity, high innovation, high growth economy, and all of those are closely interrelated in terms of what the data shows, and the links between that productivity and the wellbeing measures is absolutely borne out by the facts. Worth mentioning the impact on businesses, and if you look at this from a business perspective, businesses that are trying to do the right thing at the moment, seeking accreditation on the real living wage, looking to pay a fair wage to their employees, are faced with a dilemma, frankly, in many cases, where they're competing against other businesses that are not doing so. So the creation of that level playing field, I think, would be hugely welcome by businesses that are trying to do the right thing, to know that the opportunity for others to undercut them by not paying the real living wage is legally removed. And also, it creates a situation where Scotland can continue to attract more employees to come and live and work here from the rest of the UK, which outstrips the number that move on an annual basis in the opposite direction, something that is often forgotten in this conversation. Brian Whittle.
Brian Whittle.
Very grateful for having the key for giving me. Just a general question, it's always kind of perplexed me here in terms of how do we deal with the international trade where we're importing goods from countries where they're paying much less than what we pay in this country, therefore their goods are much, much cheaper. How do we deal with that?
Ivan McKee.
Well, I think since the introduction of the minimum wage at a UK level, which must be, what, 25 years or more ago, back in the day, that was one of the things that was raised at issue, and it's clearly proved to be absolutely not borne out by the evidence and by the performance. When a situation in the UK economy, and in Scotland's economy in particular, where we have lower unemployment levels, very low unemployment levels, and a demand for workers, which puts the lie to that claim that somehow this would damage international competitiveness. In actual fact, as is borne out by the evidence, the economies that pay their workers more are more productive, have higher standards of living, higher innovation, higher technology as a consequence of that. So having those powers means that to set that minimum wage within Scotland means that we don't need to use inefficient and indirect levers like we have to do at the moment, tiptoeing around what are reserved powers, seeking to find routes through use of conditionality and other mechanisms to help to try to drive employers to do the right thing and pay the real living wage as a minimum, be able to do that directly by the setting of those rates. And what that would do is help to drive up wage rates right across the rest of the UK, not a race to the bottom, as Labour inaccurately claims, but in fact a climb to the top. And I'd like to turn and address Labour's position on this with regard to that. So I think their interpretation of that is absolutely incorrect. clearly what they're seeking to do is to big up the prospect of a Labour government and give them something that they can announce when they ever take power at a UK level. And they want to prevent Scotland from having those powers because they want to claim that it's all down to their work. The reality is that there's absolutely no reason why a floor cannot be set at a UK level. And in parallel with that, the Scottish Parliament could have the powers from day one to take forward the measures of setting our standards at a higher level within the Scottish context. And I think that would put a lie to Labour's claim that there was perhaps some risk of a race to the bottom. So I'd be interested to get Labour's perspective on that. Demand devolution of those powers now to the Scottish Parliament, and if the UK, a future UK Labour government, wants to put a floor in place below which Scottish powers cannot, our standards cannot fall, then I think the Scottish Government would be absolutely comfortable with that as a consequence. And finally, just my ask of the Scottish Government is to do some more work, define what the process would be to calculate the Scottish minimum wage when we have those powers, calculate what its value would be in present economic circumstances, bearing in mind, of course, that that would increase over time, and do the analysis on the economic benefits of that and then publicise that rate so that people
understand
the benefits of the devolution of those powers, and also that as a stepping stone towards full independence for Scotland. Thank you very much, President Officer.
Thank you, Mr McKee. I now call Liz Smith to be followed by John Mason in around 6 minutes. Ms Smith.
Thank you, and it's a pleasure to follow Mr McKee. My colleague Murdo Fraser described him as the government in exile, but I think the journalists are saying that he's actually the government in waiting, along with his two colleagues, Michelle Thompson and Kate Forbes. And I raise this because I want to compliment the paper that the trio wrote earlier this year, because I think that was with the intention of breathing some new life into SNP policymaking after the bruising battle of a leadership election. And it talked very sensibly about developing a well-being economy, but also recognising that this would never come about unless there is a strong focus on growth and on widening the tax base. And that's something that each of them have returned to in this chamber in recent months. And they also said, and I quote, that steering the economy requires clarity on destination alongside an approach built on the understanding of all parts of a complex mechanism and how they work best together. How much the Finance Committee, Audit Scotland and the Scottish Fiscal Commission agree. So do I, even if our politics on the Constitution are profoundly different. And here's why. Because the pursuit of well-being is dependent upon the delivery of economic growth in its most traditional form. Now, I understand very well when people talk about the development of the well-being economy, about the feel-good factor, because that should be at the forefront of people's minds. Indeed, common sense tells us that delivering better opportunities for everyone results in better social and economic outcomes. And we know that the feel-good factor matters, but we also know that it's very subjective and it's quite hard to measure, as the Scottish Government has found out. The 100 or so leaders from civic society and faith groups who signed the letter in 2022 to the Scottish Government about the importance of well-being recognised that very point. And they made clear that they thought that the current national economic performance framework does not do nearly enough to put in place the basic building blocks on which Scotland can improve societal and environmental outcomes. And that's a view that is shared by the Finance Committee of this Parliament. But they were also critical of too much of a central focus on GDP as a measure of economic success, just as we know is the case for several members in this chamber. The trouble is not about the aspiration, but the means to achieve it. Well-being depends, well-being depends on our success in creating growth, on improving productivity, and on widening the tax base, exactly what Kate Forbes said should be the urgent priority of the Scottish Government. And it's a point that was echoed at the time when she said it by the Chambers of Commerce, several other economic bodies. And she was also absolutely correct to say that the status quo just won't cut it. She recognises only too well that the focus of the Scottish Government over a long period of time now has been elsewhere. And she also knows that being tied to the Bute House Agreement, where the Greens wholly reject the concept of economic growth, is a major problem for the SNP, and it's a major problem, more importantly, for Scotland. Now, Murdo Fraser, in his opening remarks, set out exactly why economic growth is important, and he provided the evidence which backs up that point. And back in April 2017 and in June 2019, we debated this importance in this chamber via Conservative motions about how we should deliver that economic growth. How we wish that the Scottish Government had been listening on these occasions, because it might have saved them. Yes, of course.
Cabinet Secretary.
President Officer, this is, of course, a debate about the contribution that fair work makes towards a wellbeing economy. And I wholeheartedly agree with the points that I actually made, that Ivan McKee makes around the contribution towards economic growth that can be made. And the examples are there. Internationally, our comparator countries in Europe are wealthier, fairer, have higher productivity, but also have better results in terms of lower poverty, higher social mobility, higher gender pay, smaller gender pay gap, higher spend in R&D. The business investment is higher, but critically, they've got higher average wages, lower proportion of low-wage workers, and fewer people in at risk of poverty in work. So why is it that those countries can focus in on the fair work elements and still be more economically successful, whereas the UK is lagging so far behind?
Liz Smith, I'm going to give
you
the time back.
Cabinet Secretary, they're not mutually exclusive. We're starting from a position that... We're starting from a position in Scotland which the Scottish Fiscal Commission has spelt out in very stark detail about why it is so important to get to the fair work and the wellbeing agenda, why we need to improve our economy in Scotland. What the Minister should be doing is asking why is it, just as Mr Rennie did, why is it that even when the UK has relatively poor growth in relation to some of these other countries, Scotland is doing even less well. That's the point, and that is something that we must address. And I won't go into all the detail about what the Scottish Fiscal Commission has said, because we have rehearsed this many times, as did John Swinney, to be fair to him, when he attended the Finance Committee before he demitted office. But it is also this debate about preventative spend. And that is something that is challenging the Finance Committee just now, about how we can make decisions that will improve our financial contributions in the future by ensuring that we are doing the right things to improve economic and social benefit just now. Finally, can I just sum up on the point of the importance of why we must concentrate on sorting this problem for the Scottish economy? We are not going to be able to deliver what we want to in terms of well-being and improving our societal and environmental outcomes unless we do. And it should be that focus, Cabinet Secretary, not the constitutional warmongering that was always going on with the SNP. That's the focus that we should have, because if we don't do that, we are not going to provide for the generations in the future.
Thank you, Ms Smith. I now call John Mason to be followed by Pam Duncan-Glancy. Around 6 minutes, Mr Mason.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I'm pleased to take part in today's debate. Now, the title of the debate, as we saw, is Fair Work in a Wellbeing Economy, and I wanted to start by reminding ourselves of some of the key principles of a wellbeing economy and where we are trying to get to. After all, devolution of employment law and powers is not an end in itself. The purpose is to build a better society. The Wellbeing Economy Alliance and others would suggest key principles include social equity, reducing income and wealth inequality, promoting social inclusion, and ensuring that the benefits of economic activities are distributed more equitably. Inclusivity, encouraging citizens' participation in decision-making and the design of economic policies to ensure that diverse perspectives and needs are considered. Long-term thinking, a shift away from short-term profit maximisation and toward long-term planning and resilience. Measuring success differently, using alternative indicators of progress beyond GDP, such as the Genuine Progress Indicator or the Human Development Index, to gauge the well-being and sustainability of an economy. Public and private sector cooperation, encouraging collaboration between government, businesses, civil society and communities to achieve shared well-being objectives. Ethical business practices, promoting ethical and socially responsible business practices which take into account the impact of business activities on people and the planet. So if we take social equity to start with, how is the UK doing? We have the 9th most unequal incomes of the 38 OECD countries, and we are above average in terms of wealth inequality. while the top fifth of the UK have 36% of the country's income and 63% of the country's wealth, the bottom fifth have only 8% of the income and 0.5% of the wealth. In 2022, the incomes of the poorest 14 million people fell by 7.5% in comparison to the richest fifth, gaining 7.8%. Clearly, the UK is not in a good place in a whole range of ways around employment. For myself, income inequality is probably the biggest issue, but restrictions on the right to strike, longer working hours, job insecurity, flexible working and lower sick pay are key issues as well. Now, I do understand that Labour might like to improve employment law right across the UK, and obviously that is a good aim. However, I was intrigued by the wording of their amendment, which talks about improving workers' rights across the UK before exploring how these rights can be entrenched through devolution of employment powers, and so on. Now, that kind of implies that at a UK level, these improved workers' rights will not be entrenched. Now, perhaps I'm misunderstanding, but I just wonder how solid these UK rights would be under Labour. But that still leaves the question that if Scotland wants to go further and achieve something better than Labour's UK-wide floor, why is that such a bad idea? If Labour in England want to settle for something less down south, why should ordinary working people here be held back? The motion calls for devolution of employment powers, and I certainly fully support that. To start with, we should be able to make the real living wage a statutory requirement, as I think Ivan McKee was suggesting, rather than the UK's lower level of national living wage. I think it was Labour's Ian Murray who said that the Scottish Government needs to use the power that it's got. But on minimum wages, that means we can only encourage and cajole employers, to pay a proper living wage. We do not have the powers to actually make it happen across the board. So what does it mean to say we should use the powers that we've got? Now, of course, if we do control employment law in the future, we do still need to be aware of what is happening across the border. Both employers and workers will have freedom of movement, and as we have found with partial devolution of income tax, we have to be wary of not being too divergent from England. However, what we can and should be doing is creating an overall environment where employment conditions, education, health services, and the whole package on offer is more attractive here than elsewhere. I'd suggest that this should also include taxation around employment, which in particular means full control of income tax and devolution of national insurance. It's hard to talk about having fair work in a well-being economy without considering the interaction between income tax and national insurance. National insurance is such a regressive system, starting at 12% for those earning over £12,576, but falling to 2% for those over £49,368. The gender pay gap is another area where we could do more if we had the powers to do so, and I fully accept that even a comparable independent country like Sweden still has a significant gender pay gap. So no one is saying that transferring the powers means problems are solved overnight, but perhaps it's more of a question of what direction are we going in and how fast we might hope to get there. And it seems to me that there is more of a desire in Scotland, possibly across all parties, to tackle something like the gender pay gap. On the subject of a wellbeing economy, I think it's worth mentioning the cross-party group on international development, which took place on Tuesday. Part of the focus there was a report by Oxfam and ActionAid, and a range of interesting and relevant points were made, including a wellbeing economy must not be about Scotland or the UK exporting their problems to the developing world. Again, there was criticism of GDP as a measure of growth or success when 65% of the work of women is excluded from GDP. And there were calls for a more feminist wellbeing economy. And in particular, care is not currently included in national outcomes, and there are pretty strong arguments that it should be. So I would urge members to support this simple, straightforward government motion. We do know what the Tories want to go, where they want to go, and we reject that. But we do not know where Labour is going. We do not know what Labour believe in or if they have any principles. And so I would suggest we reject their amendment. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr Mason. We're getting close to exhausting the time we had available earlier on in the debate. I'll try and give some latitude for interventions, but I'd be grateful if members could stick to their speaking time allocation. I call Pam Duncan-Glancy to be followed by Claire Hawkey. Up to 6 minutes, Ms Duncan-Glancy.
Thank you, Deputy President Officer, and again, I will do my best on time. The Labour Party is and always has been the party on the side of work, workers and opportunity for all. The principles of fair work are ones we not only embrace, will always stand up for and have legislated for, they're in our DNA. That's why I'm pleased to speak for Scottish Labour on this today. President Officer, I want to use my time to draw attention to an ongoing situation in my region in Glasgow, where the principles of fair work are on the line, where workers face job losses, uncertainty and their voices drowned out, and they're left feeling disrespected and disempowered. Next Tuesday, we'll see the beginning of a further 20 days of strike action at the City of Glasgow College, following 11 weeks of industrial action by EIS FILA. The dispute has been rumbling on since February this year, when the college first announced it would be increasing lecturers' workloads, reducing face-to-face contact time for students, reducing the number of learning support lecturers, and imposing two rounds of redundancy, one of which is compulsory. Decisions which have left many baffled, because, let me remind colleagues, that since reclassification in 2011, colleges have been considered as public sector bodies, and this government talks proudly of its commitment to no compulsory redundancies in the public sector, so the decision by the college seems entirely at odds. And even if we accept the claim from the City of Glasgow College that it had no other option, and I'm far from convinced of that, the way in which this situation has been handled is still deeply concerning. There are two unfolding crises here, one of governance and one of unfair work. Let me be clear, I understand the considerable financial strains facing the colleges across the country. They have faced years of real terms cuts from this government. Colleges have watched as this Parliament agreed to a budget that gave them additional resource and then were helpless when that resource was whipped away by the Scottish Government mere months later. And they've struggled to make ends meet within the limited flexibility they have to generate income. But let me also be clear, Presiding Officer, colleges need their staff and their jobs matter. The protection of jobs in these unprecedented times is vital, and decisions that put any of them at risk must only be taken as a last resort and be well informed and based on the best available evidence. I am deeply concerned that neither is the case here and that this action has been taken before exhausting all other avenues. I know the EIS FILA have worked tirelessly to try to avert this crisis for their members, and I commend them for that. They presented an alternative business case, but it was rejected by the principal with very little scrutiny from the College Board. They've also said they feel that trade union members have been targets, threatened and ridiculed, and that attempts to rebuild industrial relations have been undermined. One example was when the union tried to meet with the board separately from the principal, a reasonable request given what's going on there, and it was blocked. Another example of the disrespect for workers and industrial relations is seen in the language used in the staff update of the 3rd of November, which was entitled, "Cuts done, moving on." Presiding Officer, this is people's jobs and their livelihoods. They can't simply move on. Talking so flippantly about job losses and course cuts, especially when some staff selected for redundancy are still at work there, either because they've not yet served their notice or because they've lodged appeals, flies in the face of the principles of the fair work that we're talking about today, leaves people feeling that there is now no going back and they have no opportunity to save their jobs. The Scottish Government's own vision for employment in Scotland says that it must embody a culture of fair work and reward workers with the security they need to develop and plan for their future and their families' future. The failures of the college to meaningfully engage and consider all other options openly and then to disrespect employees the way they have has led to fair work practice being thrown out the window and is indicative of poor governance. Earlier in the year, the Minister for Further and Higher Education confirmed to me that the Scottish Funding Council could intervene in the decision to pursue compulsory redundancies. I've since wrote to them and the Scottish Government asking for this to happen, and it is yet to happen. The principal also refused a request to instigate this action himself. So far, the government have behaved largely like bystanders, not the people where the buck stops. Presiding Officer, someone has to step in. As elected representatives of many of these workers, I will give way.
Bob Doris.
Pam Duncan Glance for give way. The debate this afternoon is obviously about fair work, and we need to make sure that in corporate governance terms that public bodies in Scotland, including City of Glasgow College, have proper, transparent mechanisms in place to secure that fair work agenda. I'm not quite sure they are all robust and in place, and I'm a bit concerned about the relationship between the Funding Council,
the regional board and City of Glasgow College. Is that a concern that you would also share, Ms Glancy?
Pamela Glancy, I can give you the time back.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I thank the member for that intervention. It absolutely is a concern that I share, and the member will be aware that we're looking to work together to write to all of those parties to ask them to intervene. Because, Presiding Officer, colleagues, someone really does have to. As an elected representative of many of these workers and the students, I'm doing all I can to bring transparency and openness to the situation, protect the principles of fair work and good governance. And I acknowledge that colleagues on other benches, like the colleague who's just spoken, have been doing the same. But we are exhausting all options, and workers could be out of their job in a matter of days. So I ask the Cabinet Secretary today to reflect on what's happening in Scotland's biggest college and consider whether he is satisfied that it is upholding the standards he himself today has said he believes in and this Parliament expects, and to step in. I ask that his government investigate whether there has been mismanagement at the college, and if it concludes that duties have not been discharged properly, then it should give strong consideration to exercising its powers to intervene under Section 24 of the Further and Higher Education Scotland Act 1994. If nothing is done, there is a real risk of setting a poor precedent that has the potential to ripple through the sector, which could result in a failure to meet fair work principles elsewhere too. The fact the government has brought this debate today highlights that it recognises how important those principles are, and I welcome that. But staff at the college need deeds, not words. Jobs and livelihoods are on the line. Those people need their government to step in, and I hope the Cabinet Secretary can see how serious this is. I invite him to take the opportunity, in closing today, to set out what he and his government will do, because staff and students at Scotland's largest college are watching, and they're running out of time. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Duncan Glancy. I now call Claire Hawkey to be followed by Maggie Chapman. Up to 6 minutes, Ms Hawkey.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Fair Work is a Scottish Government commitment to ensuring everyone benefits from opportunity, security, fulfilment and respect in the workplace. Fair Work and Fair Pay makes sense for workers and employers across all sectors, helping to improve staff retention and productivity, reduce recruitment costs and contribute to a skilled and motivated workforce. Embedding it into Scottish policy making is also central to economic growth, and it means that we can better tackle social inequalities, poverty and the cost of living. Although employment powers are reserved to the UK Government, the Scottish Government is using and promoting Fair Work principles to make workplaces fairer and more inclusive. And one such way is through promoting the employer accreditation schemes, including payment of the real living wage. In Scotland, 91% of all jobs pay at least the real living wage, higher than any other UK nation, and over 3,400 employers in Scotland have real living wage accreditation. I'm proud to be one of those employers myself, and I'd also like to mention a number of businesses across my Rutherglen constituency that I've had the pleasure of visiting who are real living wage accredited. And these include, but are not limited to, Ace Place Nursery and Out of School Care, Bar Dykes Farm Nursery School, Evolution Fasteners and Thistle Credit Union. Despite the challenges of the UK economy with rampant inflation, these employers know the value of investing in their workforce, helping to improve staff morale, reduce absenteeism and support their efforts to retain and attract staff. Presiding Officer, there have been considerable challenges impacting on Scotland's Fair Work ambitions in recent years. And in my first parliamentary speech in 2016, I criticised the Tory government's ill-thought-out and unnecessary Trade Union Act, which attacks workers' fundamental rights to organise, to bargain collectively and withdraw their labour. 7 years on, and the Tories continue to attack trade unions through their minimum service level legislation. Presiding Officer, I welcome the comments earlier this week from the Cabinet Secretary for Fair Work, who said the Scottish Government will continue to do all they can to oppose this legislation and will not cooperate with establishing any minimum service orders here. But it's not only Westminster's anti-worker policies which impact on Scotland's Fair Work agenda. The UK's hard Brexit, which, let's not forget, Labour has fully signed up to, has long threatened a race to the bottom on workers' rights, and it has driven low growth, stagnant wages and the highest inequality out of neighbouring countries. Additionally, the Westminster cost of living crisis has seen energy bills skyrocket, food prices soar and mortgage rates have ballooned, all hitting workers' take-home pay. And it's abundantly clear that workers in Scotland will only get the employment protections that they need when the levers of change are placed in the hands of the Scottish people. Presiding Officer, an independent Scotland could go much further in improving pay and workers' conditions. The Scottish Government has already set out that independence will allow us to deliver higher minimum standards for statutory sick pay and parental leave, stronger access to flexible working, a repeal of the UK's draconian anti-trade union laws, the banning of cruel fire and rehire practices, the provision of full employment rights from day one of employment, as well as enshrining workers' rights into constitutional law. Now, I know that not everyone in this chamber shares our ambition for Scotland to be an independent country, but they should all back our calls for Scotland to have full powers of employment law. Of course, it's not only the SNP that are asking for this, but some of the biggest trade unions in the country. And I remind members that I am a member of Unison. And recently, and we've heard Ros Foyer quoted earlier on today, the General Secretary of the STUC, she wrote in the Herald that the STUC welcomed the TUC's now shared policy between their organisations on devolving employment law. The SNP has long campaigned for the devolution of employment powers to Scotland, but the Labour Party worked hand in glove with the Tories to block this during the Smith Commission in 2014. And more recently, Labour's Deputy Leader Angela Rayner and the Shadow Secretary for Scotland ruled out devolving employment law. And only last month, Labour MPs, including the new member for Rutherglen and Hamilton West, dodged a vote on an SNP bill to devolve employment law. Labour's newest MP failed to stand up for his Rutherglen constituents at the very first hurdle, instead falling in line behind his London bosses by abstaining and proving he really is Stammer's man in Scotland. Labour would rather leave Scotland under Westminster control and at the mercy of Tory attacks on workers' rights than give Scotland's National Parliament powers. Now, I'm deeply disappointed that despite Anna Sarwar's protestations only this week that he would love for Holyrood to have control over workers' rights in the first term of a Labour government. There's no mention of this in the Labour amendment. Presiding Officer, could it be that the UK Labour bosses down in Westminster have pulled the branch office back into line? And with Labour failing to join us, not only us in the SNP, but the trade union movement itself in calling for this much-needed devolution in the face of the Tory cost-of-living crisis and draconian anti-strike legislation, we once again find ourselves asking, what is the point of Scottish Labour? Presiding Officer... Presiding Officer, I'm a proud trade unionist. I've been a trade union member all of my working life. And before entering Parliament, I was a divisional convener for Unison. Protecting workers' rights against
the member must conclude.
And exploitative contracts, supporting their democratic right to industrial action, championing safe workplaces have long been priorities of mine. Priorities which are fundamental components of Scotland's fair work ambition. And although the Scottish Parliament
Thank you,
doesn't
Ms. Hoppe. You
the legislative
conclude.
Powers over employment law. I know this government...
Thank you,
will...
Ms. Hawhey. And I call Maggie Chapman to be followed by Mark Griffin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I am proud, like others before me, to refer colleagues to my entry in the Register of Members' Interests as a member of the Unite the Union. I am also pleased to be a member of the Living Wage Accreditation Scheme, a member of No Zero Employment Employer, a disability confident employer and care positive employer, and I'd encourage colleagues to find out more about these important schemes if they do not already know about them. We are accustomed to UK governments that want to curtail human rights, to limit them, to restrict them. But the current occupants of the Westminster merry-go-round, it seems, will not be content until fundamental rights are dismantled altogether, including the right to protest, the right to escape persecution, children's right to life, and workers' right to strike. The Overton window of acceptable views is, with every week, vanishing further rightwards, with Sir Keir Starmer rushing after it as fast as his legs will carry him, it seems. But we have a different perspective in Scotland, a different tradition which we share as trade unionists, whether or not we are unionists of other kinds. Fair work is central to that vision of Scotland as a fair work nation, sustained by a well-being economy. The Fair Work Convention's recent report highlights some key aspects in relation to the essential dimensions of fair work. On opportunity, the report is clear. The Tory obsession with an exclusionary and marginalising Brexit has constrained our labour market. Powers on employment would help ease this, if only just a bit, and allow us to make Scotland a more desirable and attractive place to live and work. The report has important reflections on respect, security, and fulfilment too. There are clear messages about needing to value more than just the financial metrics of work, of needing a step change to address inequalities across our labour force, and to ensure workers are supported to develop their skills, expertise, and knowledge while in work, as John Mason and others have already highlighted. On effective voice, the report is very clear. Things have not yet got significantly worse, but despite Scotland's best and ongoing efforts to push the envelope in terms of worker representation, Tory suppression of collective bargaining pans out in real life. So these essential dimensions of fair work, effective voice, opportunity, security, fulfilment, and respect, all require workers to have agency, choice, dignity, and the right to act collectively, including by taking industrial action. We cannot do that by aspiration alone. We need the right tools to create, shape, and hone the structures that support fair work and well-being. We can do a little with encouragement and guidance, with conditionality in contracts and investment, but without access to reserved powers, without legislative levers, our ability to act upon our principles is so very much more difficult. Scottish trade unionists recognise that reality. So why, among political actors, is there suddenly so much resistance? I've been around long enough to have heard it before as a member of the Smith Commission, and again here just a few weeks ago during Keith Brown's members' debate. That inexplicable no in response to the ask for employment law to be devolved is expressed in two different ways. The Tories talk about the convenience of employers, and Labour about the need for that so-called floor, somehow failing to see that the floor is already crumbling away beneath our feet. Neither story really makes that much sense. It is quite literally the height of insularity to imagine that people right across the world don't routinely live in one jurisdiction and work in another. And within the UK, we already have substantially different employment law in Northern Ireland and in Great Britain. Meanwhile, more and more people are employed by multinational corporations, which don't just cope with two employment law jurisdictions, but with very many. Yes, no doubt it would be handy for some employers who don't yet recognise the shared benefits of fair work to keep Scotland tied down by Westminster's anti-worker legislation. But that's only because the Westminster laws are regressive, not because of corporate systems that thrive on jurisdictional complexity will somehow collapse if things are slightly different in Dundee and Derby. The way to avoid a race to the bottom is to turn around and start racing, or at least climbing, towards the top. To give up resisting at all, clinging to the biggest bully as he drags you down, really doesn't help. You might squeal, "This wasn't my idea," as you fall, but the bottom is still where you end up. That is not where the Scottish people want to be. Whether they vote Green or Labour, SNP or Lib Dem, they want robust and realised workers' rights. Even the Scottish Tories, and I mean this as a compliment, are refreshingly wet in comparison to their Westminster counterparts on this issue. We want fair work. We want a well-being economy. We have a remarkable degree of consensus about the kind of country we want to be. And it isn't a hollowed-out, homogenous land of silent streets and silenced unions. To create something different is to challenge the inevitability of that future, to show both what is possible and how we can reach it. We won't refuse the tools to create it on the off chance that Sir Keir discovers his conscience after winning an election. But we need those tools now, and we need to use them now. Thank you.
Thank you. And I call Mark Griffin to be followed by Pam Gosselin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I apologise to you, Presiding Officer, the Chamber and the Cabinet Secretary for missing a chunk of his speech on late arrival to the Chamber. I was facilitating a meeting with the Minister for Public Health and mothers of premature babies who were putting forward powerful contributions towards her, and I felt that I couldn't curtail that discussion, and I hope the Chamber understands that. Earlier today as well, the Social Justice and Social Security Committee started taking evidence on my bill that would establish Scotland's Employment Injuries Advisory Council. That would put workers at the heart of our new injury benefit, and that council could be an expert panel for those who know their workplaces and the dangers they face best. It's key to embedding fair work principles in our social security system. And key here is that it's something we should be doing with our powers this Parliament already has. Delivering on that shared ambition to, as the government motion says, make Scotland a fair work nation, but has not yet happened. The Fair Work Convention, in its support of the bill, agrees that it would ensure the principles of fair work, including effective voice, are underpinned in the delivery of this new benefit. And although the DWP is still delivering the benefit, and it hasn't kept pace with the world we now live in, the Convention went on to say, at its most basic, the benefit recognises the health, safety and well-being of others in the workplaces and aligns with the fair work principle of respect. And giving workers their effective voice, giving them that role in the new benefit, is why the bill is backed by the SDUC, 16 trade unions, as well as a range of organisations including Close the Gap, Action on Asbestos, Scottish Hazards and Long Covid Scotland. Because, Presiding Officer, it's the key workers with long COVID, care workers wrestling with back and joint problems, firefighters more likely to get cancer from toxic contaminants, and women workers who are outright ignored by the current UK benefit. They all want answers about how Scotland's new industrial injuries benefit can help them, but have no voice in the current process, no seat at the table in what government says it's setting up. And it's worrying, it's one area where this government could be using powers now to extend our ambitions to be a fair work nation. It's one of the final pieces of the jigsaw required to fully establish Scotland's new social security system. But earlier in the week, the Social Justice Cabinet Secretary confirmed that not enough progress has been made on delivering that system. The committee had asked for a timescale but didn't get it. And timing appears, and the need for yet more consultation is the key reason the government says it will vote down a bill that would secure effective voice for Scotland's workers. And truth be told, though, current stock responses contemplating asking whether a council is needed at all, I don't think for a second the Cabinet Secretary or the government would try and create a workers' benefit without giving them a seat at that table, nor do I believe that the government would contemplate that it would possibly be the right solution to leave that task to a UK council with no Scottish voices and which this government is now not allowed to ask information from. I think that the fact is that the government has left to last the benefit it considers the most complex. The promises of consultations have been and gone, still workers are no wiser of when they will get their effective voice, when they will get their seat at the table. The government is short of an opinion of whether there should be a council at all. But government organisations, government established organisations, the Fair Work Convention, the Disability and Carers Benefits Expert Advisory Group, my consultation, the committee's call for review, all concluded that there absolutely should be one. The government's own consultation, which led to the recently introduced Social Security Amendment Bill, said there was a preference for splitting off advice and scrutiny, and its own independent review of SCOS said that it is very clear that it would not be appropriate for them to have an advisory role. So, Presiding Officer, I want to say that there is a risk that this government runs out of time to include workers, giving workers their effective voice, giving them their place round the table in this benefit from the very outset. In its own legal agreement with the UK Government, the Scottish Government has agreed that it will deliver both a business transition and case transfer plan a year ahead of the contract running out, a year ahead of agency agreements coming to an end. Now, given that ministers now have just short of 17 months to set out something that they have in 5 years failed to do, the government should absolutely urgently set out to workers how they will be embedded in the design, the advice and scrutiny of the new injury benefit to embed their voice. Presiding Officer, industrial injuries benefit was built on the backs of workers lost, injured and disabled before us. This Parliament absolutely owes it to them that workers injured or made ill at work continue to turn to a no-blame social security scheme and have an effective voice in shaping its future. Thank you.
Thank you. And I call Pam Gosell to be followed by Kevin Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I am pleased for the opportunity to contribute to this debate, and I will be supporting the amendment in the name of my colleague, Murdo Fraser. Today's government motion speaks about how the UK government's approach to workers works against the ambitions to make Scotland a fair work nation. And then, in his opening comments, the Cabinet Secretary tried to paint a picture of a UK government that couldn't care less about fair work. This is not the first time this SNP government has used valuable debate time to create constitutional grievance. But the truth of the matter is somewhat different. Not only is fair work a priority for the UK government, but it is fair to say that the UK has one of the best records on workers' rights in the world. The UK already has a minimum wage higher. I'd like to make some progress, thank you. The UK already has a minimum wage higher than in most EU member states, with this having increased to £10.42 in April, and those aged over 23. But now, the Chancellor has announced that from next April, the minimum wage will be increased to 2/3 of the average earnings. This is in line with recommendations from the Low Pay Commission and is a move which will see a pay increase of over £1,000 per year for over 2 million low-paid workers, including over 180,000 workers in Scotland. I find it interesting that, despite the Scottish Government's willingness to talk about the fair work, they cannot at least bring themselves to welcome this increase. Nor should we, I'd like to make some progress, thank you. Nor should we forget that UK has 52 weeks statutory maternity leave, or which up to 39 weeks can be taken as paid leave. This is nearly three times the EU equivalent. But fair work is not a finished project, and the UK government is continuing to do more in this area. The maximum fine for employers who mistreat workers has been quadrupled, and the recommendations from the Taylor Review of Modern Working Practices are continuing to be implemented. Presiding Officer, far from working against the Scottish Government's ambitions in this area, Scotland's place in the UK provides a fantastic starting point for Scotland as a fair work nation. Yeah. But as our amendments set out, progress on fair work depends on Scottish Government changing direction on this issue and focusing on effective pro-market policies to improve job prospects across Scotland. Our amendments highlight that the Scottish Government's record in this area is one of a sluggish growth and a lack of competitiveness. For example, the Scottish wage growth has fallen compared to the rest of the UK. The Scottish businesses are also struggling, with just 9% of companies in Scotland believing that the SNP understands business. Yep. And one in six shops in Scotland are currently lying empty, which is a higher rate than the UK average. Yep. Presiding Officer, what this all shows is that there is plenty more that the Scottish Government could be doing on this issue themselves. The SNP's strategy of repeatedly attacking the UK government on workers' rights and the economy is nothing more than a deflection tactic. Yeah. Instead of deflection, it is time for action from this SNP government. As we speak about it in our grasping the thistle paper, this action should include measures such as developing new skills strategy with an emphasis on colleges, apprenticeships and lifelong learning. This would allow the government to deliver a national workforce plan to ensure that our labour market has the skills that businesses and employers will need in the coming years. But this also must mean for the SNP government putting some of these recent talk into action and ensuring that the long-term growth is a key economic priority of this government. And I'm quite happy to share this report on grasping the thistle paper that actually provides real economic growth, real actions that will make a difference out there in Scotland. So I'm quite happy to share this with the SNP government. In conclusion, presiding officer, the UK already has one of the best packages of workers' rights in the world. And the UK government is continuing to do its part to ensure that the principle of fair work can go alongside a competitive, flexible labour market. Meanwhile, the SNP government is failing to acknowledge its own failures in this area. Instead, they are once again trying to fight constitutional battles with today's debate. The onus now sits with the Scottish Government to use the powers at their disposal to improve productivity and employment levels in Scotland and work constructively with the UK Government to achieve an effective fair work approach for both employees and the economy, to allow Scotland to continue to be the best places in the world to live and work. Thank you.
Thank you. And I call Kevin Stewart, the final speaker in the open debate.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I refer members to my register of interests. I'm a member of Unison. Presiding Officer, I welcome the opportunity to once again discuss fair work in a wellbeing economy in this place. And I'll start off by saying that the picture that Ms. Gosell has just painted is not what workers and trade unions in Scotland, in the UK, see from the Tory UK government. There is no an improvement in fair work here. In fact, Tory crackdowns on worker protections and the rights of unions has seen the UK's global rating on workers' rights fall, and fall dramatically over the piece. And with draconian legislation like the EU Retained Law Bill and the Anti-Strike Bill passed through the UK Parliament earlier this year, it is very clear that protecting workers' rights is not on the Tory agenda, and it is more important than ever that we fight them on this issue. And I'll take Mr. Johnson, Presiding Officer.
I'm very grateful to the member for giving way, because I'm going to sneak in while I think we can still rescue some consensus. I'm guessing something might be coming down the line. But would you equally condemn, I think, that the minimum service levels that have just been introduced, which are in effect depriving people of their ability to withdraw their labour?
Kevin Stewart.
I could condemn every single aspect of this that the Tory government has put forward, and that's why I think it's very, very bizarre that any Conservative member would stand here today and say that the UK was a fair work nation, because it certainly is not, and it is moving backwards. Presiding Officer, many things have been discussed today, and I want to discuss an important issue which has been overlooked, and it's not in, in the Labour amendment, which covers a lot of all of this, and that's around about young workers. Because Labour quotes the TUC in their amendment, but in the TUC's own words, young workers are most likely to be in insecure work, in low-paid jobs and without opportunities to progress at work than any other age group. This is backed by Unison, who say that young people experience age discrimination by being belittled, passed over for jobs, or being paid poor wages just because they are young. And it's not just the trade unions. According to a report in the London School of Economics Business Review, younger employees can be perceived as lazy, less reliable, less conscientious, less organised, selfish and poorly motivated simply because of their age, none of which is true. As a result, young people can be overlooked for training opportunities, increases in responsibility and promotions. This results in younger workers receiving lower pay and benefits relative to similarly experienced older workers, and they are more at risk of being laid off during a downturn. And of course, Where one discrimination starts, others follow soon after. The discrimination of marginalised groups starts as soon as young people join the workforce. 2/3 of young women have experienced sexual harassment at work, and nearly 6 in 10 ethnic minority young workers have experienced racism at work. With employment law in the control of this Parliament, we can strengthen protections against discrimination to ensure that young workers are treated fairly in the workplace. And I would hope that Labour supports the view of equal pay for equal work, but British employment law enshrines the exact opposite, and the Labour amendment doesn't bother mentioning it. The national minimum wage is tapered against young workers. While it's £10.42 at the moment for the over 23s, it goes down to £10.18 for 21-year-olds, £7.49 for 18-year-olds, and only £5.28 for 17-year-olds. It's often argued that young people deserve poorer wages as they get training on the job, but there's nothing to ensure that this actually happens. The reality is that many young workers are employed to do work that requires little or no additional training or experience, and British employment law is used as an excuse to pay them less simply because they are young. With the powers in the hands of this Parliament, we can ensure that young workers receive either the full living wage of quality career improving on-the-job training to make the difference that's required. Today's young workers are tomorrow's entrepreneurs. They're tomorrow's industry leaders, and they are the backbone of Scotland's future prosperity. And by helping facilitate their future growth and development by improving on-the-job vocational training programmes to provide young workers with valuable skills and experience, increasing their employability and earning potential, making it easier for young workers to take time off for training and education without fear of being penalised. We can do that all if employment law is devolved to this Parliament. Now, we have heard great things in this debate and others from Labour around about what they intend to do in government, but we have seen a lot of Labour flip-flopping of late. We have seen the Labour Party in a guddle because of the flip-flopping that there has been. And the reason why Labour has a problem with employment law being devolved to Scotland is becoming clearer by the day.
Thank you.
Quite
Mr.
simply,
Stewart,
if Scotland
conclude,
were to
please.
Improve workers' rights and deliver fair work for all, Labour in London would have to follow suit, and that would require Keir Starmer to find his socialist soul, and it's getting clearer by
Thank
the day.
Thank you, Mr.
That
Stewart.
He doesn't
We move to winding up speeches, and I call on Daniel Johnson, up to 6 minutes, please.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer, and what a note to pick up on. But let's begin with a bit of a reflection. Fair work is a really important topic, but let's not pretend it's simple to deliver. And it's not... Just a moment, Cabinet Secretary, and if you want to intervene, you'll have plenty of opportunities to. But let's not pretend that it's simple, or that employment law is a single magic bullet to deliver it. Let's be very clear, there's a broad range of macro and microeconomic policies that you need to develop. But unfortunately, we've not really heard much about that today. We've not heard much about employability, not heard much about education and skills, not heard much about removing zero-hours contracts as a definition of a positive destination. And there are lots of things we could have done, but what we've focused on is devolution of employment law. Because it seems to me, and listening to many of the speakers, indeed the last one, the SNP are much more interested about attacking the Labour Party than they are actually about making progress on this important matter. Because let's be very clear about what our amendment does and does not do. The words, that in terms of the operative words, are leave out. Not leave out to end. We don't remove devolution of employment law. We simply insert what we propose to do within 100 working days to bring forward legislation to enhance employment law. Because as Maggie Chapman Just in a moment. Because, as Maggie Chapman rightly points out, we have seen a crumbling floor under the Conservatives. And what the New Deal for Working People do was to repair that floor and set out a framework within which devolution of employment law can occur. And I believe there was someone wanting to intervene. Was it Claire Hawkey?
Claire Hawkey.
Thank you. I thank Daniel Johnson for that. And I hear what you're saying about the various subjects that haven't been discussed in this debate today. But does he not think that actually his arguments might carry a bit more weight if there were more Labour members here actually to discuss fair work and workers' rights, rather than the three that have been in the chamber this afternoon? Yeah.
Daniel Johnson.
They're all listening intently online. And as every member knows, this is a hybrid chamber. But look, very critically, what we have heard is acknowledgement that a floor would be useful from Ivan McKee. If John Mason said that we need to be careful of divergence. And that is precisely why you need to be very careful. You said that you can't just do it instantaneously. You'd want to create a framework, which is exactly what... So I'd ask SNP members, if they think that devolution is important of employment law, if they think we would need to take care, why would you vote against our amendment? Why would you vote against our amendment that would improve workers' rights, not just here in Scotland, but across the UK? I think Elizabeth was first, just a moment. But critically, I would ask this. Ivan McKee sort of begged the question why we thought a Labour government might be able to take power. Well, look, I know we can't rely on opinion polls, but there's at least a suggestion that it's possible. And if it's not going to be the Labour Party that legislates to devolve employment law, who would it be? I don't see the Tories doing it anytime soon. And there is a very simple choice. Do you want to vote for a Labour government that will bring this forward in 100 working days to improve workers' rights, or vote for another Conservative government? Because that's the choice facing people at the next election. Happy to give way to Liz Smith.
Liz Smith.
Mr. Johnson, who's usually very assiduous in his analysis of what business wants, has he done any analysis whatsoever on how many businesses in Scotland actually want the devolution of these employment laws? Because I can't find very many.
Daniel Johnson.
Look, what I would say to Liz Smith is this, and in reflection on another point of the debate, is that you need to actually understand that improving employment practice, improving fair work, is something that you need to do in conjunction with business. And absolutely, bringing forward those proposals require that sort of interrogation. Because actually, I thought we had a very interesting dialogue between the SNP and the Conservative front benches, between Neil Gray and Murdo Fraser, where we seem to have a very artificial binary choice presented, whether it was between fair work or a new deal for business. And I would just genuinely reflect this as a former... Okay, well, look, in all fairness, this is a genuine reflection. As somebody who's been through the steps of introducing the real living wage, it is not straightforward. It took us 3 years in our business to deliver it and implement it. It took careful planning. It's not, I think, a question of browbeating or telling people to do it. And actually, if the Scottish Government was really serious about it, it would look about how it could provide the assistance to enable businesses to go down this. I don't think it's either or. And I would say equally, I'll just come to the Cabinet Secretary in a moment, equally about providing that assistance. But I would also say to the Conservatives, most businesses want to do the right thing. They want to do right by their people. They want to ensure that they're paid well for the valuable work they do. And I think there's actually the reality is somewhere in the middle. We need assistance towards fair work and recognising businesses want to do that. Very happy to give way.
Cabinet Secretary.
I challenge Daniel Johnson's assertion that I suggested in any way that you either get economic growth or you get social progress, because actually the two happen together, have to happen in tandem. When you have a good society and a good economy, the two are mutually dependent. And in response to that, and to agree with him around the challenge that there is, particularly in a UK cost crisis around businesses choosing to invest in their people, I ask him to applaud the efforts that have been made by the Scottish Government, investing in the Poverty Alliance, the Real Living Wage campaign, that has seen 5 times the proportion of employers in Scotland paying the real living wage because of the work that we have done. 91% of employees over the age of 18 receiving the real living wage. That's success, is it not?
In conclusion, Mr. Johnson.
Of course I applaud that, because I was one of those employers before I entered this place. But look, there is a very simple choice. In the last Labour government, introduced the minimum wage, enhanced trade union recognition rights, introduced the Equality Act. The next Labour government will get rid of zero-hours contracts, will ban fire and rehire, give day-one rights of employment, and that is the choice facing the government, between more of the same or a Labour government that will actually make a difference for fair work and workers' rights. Thank you very much.
Thank you, and I call on Brian Whittle.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I rise to close this debate on behalf of the Scottish Conservatives. A debate which, when it was first mooted, filled me with so much hope. Hope that we would finally see a Scottish Government who are prepared to accept the poor record of supporting Scottish business and begin to repair that relationship. A Scottish Government finally prepared to accept that economic growth was in fact important in delivering capital to support our public services, especially in the light of the fact that since 2014, economic growth has lagged behind the rest of the UK. As highlighted by my colleague Murdo Fraser, had Scotland's economy just matched the rest of the UK, the Scottish budget would have benefited to the tune of £7 billion. But no, Presiding Officer, that hope was dashed on the rocks of a Scottish Government grievance. And we'll get a wee bit of progress. And as Murdo Fraser went on to say, this Scottish Government debate has followed every other Scottish Government debate, and there is no subject that the SNP are willing to take any responsibility for. There is no subject that the SNP are not prepared to twist into a constitutional grievance. In their obsessive drive for divergence from any UK policy, it seems that the SNP care not about the impact on the ground for our businesses and our workforce, be that higher taxation or different, more restrictive employment law. Or as Murdo Fraser pointed out, the SNP going along lending a deaf ear to major Scottish government bodies, major industry bodies such as the Retail Consortium or the CBI when they were warned the Scottish Government about the harm such divergence places on Scottish business. No, Presiding Officer, there is no price the Scottish Government won't pay, no Scottish business, no amount of potential Scottish revenue they won't sacrifice at the feet of the constitutional altar. Of course I will, Cabinet Secretary.
Cabinet Secretary.
I have two of Brian Whittle's assertions that they challenge. The first is, my very opening paragraph said, our vision for a wellbeing economy is one which supports fair, green economic growth. So the very first line that I talked about, I spoke about the importance of economic growth. The second is somehow that business does not want to see Fair Work progress when we have in Scotland five times the number of employers proportionately paying the real living wage. They want to see Fair Work and they're implementing it. Why can't he accept that?
Brian Whittle.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that intervention because it allows me once again to highlight to him how many of these businesses want devolvement of law.
Exactly.
Because there is no recognition from the Cabinet Secretary that the higher inequality and lower productivity in Scotland's economy that the Cabinet Secretary talks about in the government motion rests squarely at the feet of a tired one-trick pony of an SNP Green government that has no understanding of the real world of business. 16 years of the SNP with their delusions of adequacy has left Scotland's business community in no doubts that their needs have been a distant afterthought in the SNP world of constitutional grievance. Presiding Officer, but I would like to highlight what I thought was an excellent speech from my colleague Liz Smith, where she took the opportunity of examining where we should be going when we discuss fair work linked to the wellbeing economy. If we had followed that suit, we could be discussing what we could be discussing is the drag on the economy that is the result of economic inactivity, especially with the greater proportion of Scotland's inactivity being attributable to a persistent poor health record. Can I just finish this point? I'll give way. A health record that now sees the cost of obesity to Scotland's economy rising to £5 billion. Poor mental health now stands at £4.5 billion, and diabetes and related conditions costing 10% of the NHS budget, not to mention our frightening levels of drug and alcohol abuse. Liz Smith eloquently stated that the pursuit of wellbeing is dependent upon the delivery of economic growth, something that the SNP's partners in government, the Greens, do not believe in. She went on to say that the wellbeing depends on our success on creating growth, on improving productivity and on widening the tax base, hitting a very big nail with a very big hammer. We need sustained economic growth to pay for the efforts to tackle that increasing inequality of opportunity and create the reality of a well-being economy for Scotland. So in that vein, I would reiterate the economic inactivity in Scotland and the concerning proportion of Scotland's inactivity attributable to health problems, some of which I have already mentioned. This includes an increase in flows into early retirement because of that poor health record. I'll give way to the member.
Bob Doris.
I thank Brian Whittle for giving way. You mentioned economic inactivity. A lot 40% of people universal credit are part-time workers and still claim universal credit. Do you think it's part of the Fair Work agenda for the UK government to sanction for people who are in work? Because that's what the UK government are doing right now. So as part of the Fair Work agenda, do you think sanctions for those in work on universal credit should end? Because I certainly do.
Brian Whittle.
I'm sorry, but I actually don't recognise what the member is describing there, because I've just recently just worked with the DWP, and they're doing phenomenal work around universal credit and making sure that those the uptake in universal credit is correct. And also, if you're talking about part-time work,
let's hear Mr. Whittle.
If you're in part-time work, it's really important that your salary is augmented by universal credit. I don't see where the problem is in that. Now, I have not a lot of time left. I've always said that education was the solution to health and welfare, and if the Scottish Government would actually tackle the crisis in our healthcare from a preventative perspective, it would allow that decrease in the need to spend in preventable conditions to be reinvested in other areas of the healthcare that we so desperately need. The starting point for this is investment in our education system, where there are so many interventions that could be made that would directly tackle poor health and inequality outcomes, inequalities that will probably currently follow a person throughout their life. So, Presiding Officer, invest in our education system, increase access to opportunity, linking education to the huge potential that the green economy can bring to Scotland. Give pupils access to a much broader education that includes physical activity and sport for all, as well as music, art, drama and outdoor learning. This kind of approach fosters confidence, resilience and aspiration. The inevitable outcomes are improved attainment, which in turn feeds economic growth. These are just a few examples of how spending on one page of a ledger means reducing the need to spend on another. And unfortunately, Presiding Officer, SNP Greens do not seem capable of joining up policy dots and cannot think beyond their one and only obsession. Until we have a government that actually considers the economy out with this extremely narrow bandwidth of constitution, Scotland's economy will continue to suffer. And I do wonder how long the SNP Green Scottish Government can go on dodging responsibility for the mess that they have created. And I suspect it's dawning to many that that time is already past. I urge the Chamber to support the amendment in the name of Murdo Fraser. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, and I call on Jamie Hepburn to wind up, if you can take us to 5 p.m, Minister.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. And can I begin by welcoming the fact that we've had this debate? If nothing else, what it has done is offer us clarity on who stands where, yeah, on the question of where responsibility and power for creating a fair work society through employment law should reside. I want to take each amendment in turn. I want to start with Mr. Fraser's amendment, which we might have traditionally called a wrecking amendment. This is supposed to be a debate focused on how we can create a fair work nation, and much in the vein of his and other Conservative members' contributions, there is only a cursory reference to fair work in his amendment. But let's look at the amendment, and it also refers to grasping the thistle. We've been implored. Mr. Hoy says I should read it. I'll come to that. We were implored to read Grasping the Thistle. I want to, first of all, give reassurance that no great government expense has been spent on securing the glossy copy that Pam Gosell is good. We've got a printout here. I have, in fact, read Grasping the Thistle. So let's turn to Grasping the Thistle.
Let's hear the Minister.
The first thing I should say is got a very nice picture of Mr. Fraser leaning casually against a fence with the countryside in the background. What I can say, Presiding Officer, is the fence takes a wonderful picture. But what I'd say about Grasping the Thistle, you know, there's something that is not objectionable in its own right. It talks about parity of esteem between apprenticeships and tertiary education. No problem with that. It talks about the need for a repopulation strategy. This government has a population task force. Noticed that Grasping the Thistle, just to re-emphasise, I have in fact looked at it, Mr. Hoy. I noticed that it talks about the need to incentivise international migration, which is why we look forward to next week's debate on the Banse paper on migration and independent Scotland, the debate that the Conservatives didn't want to happen. But I have to say, the rest of it seems to be, and unsurprisingly, because it's Mr. Fraser's document straight out of the Milton Friedman school of thought, you know, and that was characterised by his use of the term when we're talking about how we might use employment law in the sense of being restrictive. I thought that was telling, because he really means by that is that he doesn't want to see employment law used in any fashion to support people in the labour market. Let's look at where the labour market is currently in the United Kingdom. Right now, with its relatively deregulated labour market, we've not seen that lead to higher wages. We've not seen that lead to greater levels of worker retention. We've not seen that lead to higher levels of productivity. Rather, what it sees is a high proportion of low-wage jobs, a high level of income inequality, high gender wage gap, although improving here in Scotland more than it is in the rest of the UK, and high economic insecurity. I thought John Mason was quite right to make these points. And similarly, Kevin Stewart also alluded to this. As was reported in June, the International Trade Union Confederation's annual report on worker rights reported that the UK has dropped from a rating of 3 countries where they consider there to be a regular violation of rights to 4, where the Confederation says there are systemic violations. To put that in context, Presiding Officer, that means the UK now ranks alongside Qatar, where we saw all of those concerns expressed about the manner in which workers were treated in the run-up to the 2022 World Cup. The UK is ranked at the same as Qatar. So that's the great record that Pam Gosal speaks of, and that's the reality of the UK in 2023. Also, turning again to grasping the thistle, you know, the elements of thought that could be viewed to be reasonable on the face of it. The rest of it was talking about stuff like sacking public workers, following Liz Truss and Kwasi Kwarteng and the race to the bottom in terms of the tax-cutting agenda. But we've seen how well that has landed us in terms of where the UK economy is with inflation. So if there's any doubt about it, let me say, President Officer, we will not be supporting Mr Fraser's amendment this evening. Of course I'll give way.
Murdo Fraser.
First of all, I am delighted that the Minister is taking such a close interest in grasping the thistle, and look forward to discussing that with him further. But on this question of public sector workers, has he completely forgotten what Kate Forbes said when she was Finance Secretary, evidence she came and gave to the Finance Committee and others, saying that the headcount of the public sector in Scotland had to be reduced? Does he not accept that that is the case?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, of course, that's in the context of the reality of us having to deal with austerity measures that are reducing the amount of the resource available for the deployment of public funds. The difference is that you want to see, beg your pardon, President, so Mr Fraser wants to see it as a key economic objective, as a key economic driver, as set out in Grasping the Thistle.
Let me just reassure
Mr Fraser, yes, I've given it some attention, but I do not endorse Grasping the Thistle for the avoidance of doubt. Let me turn to the other amendment that is before us in the name of Mr Johnson. I have to say, Mr Fraser, who I've never taken for a cynic, of course, before, he suggested, seemed to be suggested, that the purpose of this debate was to embarrass the Labour Party. I have to say, it doesn't take these benches to embarrass the Labour Party. If you look at the amendment that the Labour Party have laid before us today, that is the source of embarrassment for the Labour Party. If we look back at the time of the Smith Commission, there was an opportunity for us to secure additional powers for the Scottish Parliament. It was the opportunity to see the devolution of employment law, and the Labour Party opposed it. I was delighted then when seemingly the Labour Party changed position and said they wanted to see the devolution of employment law to this place. Better the sinner repenteth, Presiding Officer. But now, as we head in to the United Kingdom general election, let's consider what the Labour Party is saying about the devolution of employment law. Claire Hawkey already referred to the comments of Angela Rayner when she has given indication that she doesn't support the devolution. We've seen Ian Murray, the man who would be Secretary of State for Scotland, asked by the Daily Record if he was persuaded that a Labour government should devolve more power to Holyrood. He said, not personally, no. These are the individuals that those benches would have us trust to deliver devolution of employment law to this place, and they're saying they won't do it. I'll give way to Mr Johnson.
Daniel Johnson.
I'm very grateful, and I just note that he's done anything but actually look at what our amendment actually does, which is say that we will legislate and then seek to devolve employment law. It's really that simple. What's the problem that the Minister has?
Minister.
Well, I have to say, Mr Johnson, earlier in responding to an intervention, he thought he'd set the record straight. I think he needs to listen to himself, because he should read his amendment. It doesn't say that the Labour Party will devolve these powers. It's meagre. It's tepid. It's insipid. It says that the UK government should explore the devolution of employment law, not that it will devolve employment law. In stark contrast to the position of the Scottish Trades Union Congress that supports devolution of employment law. In stark contrast, the position of the UK-wide Trades Union Congress that surely believes in improving employees' rights across the UK that can still support the devolution of employment law. I'll give away one more time.
Daniel Johnson.
And would he acknowledge that the TUC, when they did that, said that that would be subject to a UK floor, and noting which, at that debate, Unite said that the SNP couldn't be trusted with workers' rights. Would he acknowledge those points from the TUC debate?
Minister.
Well, let me say, I have no problem with us considering. I support independence for this country. I think that's a way we can guarantee people's rights in Scotland. I understand that the Labour Party don't support that, but at a minimum, I would expect them to support the devolution of employment law. And if that came with some floor, of course we'd have to look at that and consider it. I'm quite relaxed at that prospect. But again, that is not what Mr Johnson's amendment says. It says it should be explored. That, frankly, is not good enough. There was a question raised, and I think, to be fair, it is a legitimate question to raise in terms of what are we doing with the limited powers that we have to try and create a fair work nation. And I'm pleased to say this government's doing plenty. If you look at our promotion of the real living wage, not the Tory contract living wage, the real living wage being celebrated this Living Wage Week, we support the accreditation scheme for the real living wage, which has seen five times the level of businesses accredited in Scotland by comparison to the rest of the UK, which sees Scotland the best performing of all four UK nations in terms of the proportion of the workforce paid the real living wage. We're supporting the Living Hours Accreditation Scheme to try and make sure that employers provide a guaranteed minimum of 16 hours a week. We're putting in place Fair Work First, which has seen the application of some £4 billion worth of public sector funding since 2019 to implement fair work in our labour market. That's what we can do with the powers that we have in our hands. But we're working against a system where we have a UK government that is putting in place something pulling in the opposite direction. Inadequate enforcement of minimum employment standards, the introduction of the Trade Union Act, plans to introduce fees for employment tribunals, and most recently, the Strikes Minimum Services Levels Act. President Officer, we can do better than that. We can do better than that with the devolution of employment law to this place, not just for this government to administer, but for this whole Parliament to legislate for. Surely that's something we can get behind. We should vote for the motion in the name of Neil Gray.
Thank you. That concludes the debate on fair work in a wellbeing economy. And it's now time to move on to the next item of business. And there are three questions to be put as a result of today's business. The first question is that Amendment 11161.2 in the name of Murdo Fraser, which seeks to amend Motion 11161 in the name of Neil Gray on fair work in a wellbeing economy, be agreed. Are we all agreed? The Parliament is not agreed, therefore we'll move to a vote, and there'll be a short suspension to allow members to access digital voting.